Welcome to The Moms I Know with Sheila Walsh Denton and Maria Elaine Anderson Farner, two moms on a mission to reclaim childhood and take you from surviving to thriving on your parenting journey.
Hi there, this is Sheila.
And this is Maria.
And we want to welcome you to
The Moms I Know.
To everything, there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven. Ecclesiastes.
Nice. So today we're going to be talking about seasons with activities, seasons of life, seasons, in the rhythm of our family life. So we were thinking it's summer right now here in Soquel, and it's also a time of transition. I can feel that subtle shift. End of July, we're in high summer. People are coming to the beach, they're vacationing, they're having a wonderful time, but we're aware that there's this shift coming.
August is the whole month of Sundays. We are waiting. And now for my kids, school is getting started. We're starting August 13th or August 15th.
Oh.
You know, and I know in some places their summer schools are still, you know, are still going, and then they're going to have the preschool stuff going on. And I think my favorite season is summer for sure. What's your favorite season?
Summer always has been, yeah. Even from when I was a child. I enjoyed school very much, but when summertime came, it was just this time of freedom, of expansion, of being able to slow down our pace, slow down the rhythm of life. And so still as an adult, there is that aspect of it. But I also, there's something about the fall and that sort of drawing in and getting ready for the winter. And then, of course, winter, the hunkering down by the fire and the long nights for storytelling and the different activities that you can do. And then spring again, this whole rebirth, this renewal, the awakening of the senses, all of the new growth. And so really appreciating every season. So we're looking at the seasons of the year, but then we can also be looking at the seasons of life. And so, you know, you think of new birth with all of the babies that are in our realm right now. We have lots of new babies that are coming. And so that's sort of that spring, and then childhood is the summer, and then the fullness of life, the mid years, and then, you know, just winter is sort of that elderly stage, the winter of our lives. And so, but I think today we're going to be talking more about sort of the different activities and the different emotions that come with all of those. So, of course, we've been talking a lot about summer and play and activities and river rafting and all sorts of different things around that. And I think that I've also been hearing of a lot of teenagers who have homework and this whole concept of, wait a minute, summer is for that breathing out, that expansion.
Let summer be summer, right? Mm-hmm. I know, I feel the same way. And I really love that you did that seasons of life. I don't think I've ever heard that really, mm-hmm. But that really makes sense. Two of my children do have summer assignments, and it's one of those things where I'm having to be on them, and that's not something I want to do in the summer, mm-hmm. because of course it is a time of expansion. And I want to say, Maria, you were the one when I would ask you, when you were our homeschool teacher, Do I sign the kids up for reading camp? Do I sign the kids up for, you know, how do I schedule them this summer? And you were always such an advocate of let kids be kids, let them have their summer. And I'd say for the most part, that's what we have done. And I am so grateful for that advice, you know, because my children, they have not been inundated with the camps and the overscheduling and the everything, because we have been around and we do our family trips together. So they've gotten the recreation, they've gotten those experiences. And I do believe there is there's a season to be bored.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what summer is for, right?
And long car trips.
And long car trips, exactly.
I think boredom is an opportunity for children to really use their imaginations and to exercise that ability to think for themselves and to create and to just explore. So with that, I know that all kinds of things do come up in the summer. And so, of course, do what feels right to your family. But as always, I think, you know, there's going to be more of this recommendation to slow down. And not as many people are going to be saying that. So I think Sheila and I are really advocates for that slowing down in the summertime.
You don't have to do it all. You know, you don't have to do, there is oftentimes I've learned this acronym. I don't know if you know it, the FOMO.
Oh,
fear,
right.
Fear of missing out.
Yeah.
You know, I think a lot of parents feel that for their children, if they don't sign up for this, that, or the other thing, they're going to miss out. But the thing is that we're going to have another summer.
They're going to miss out on childhood right. if they sign up for all of those things. So, exactly. Right. But then people always ask me, well, what about reading? Well, I don't see reading as a subject in school. I see reading as a life skill and something that is just a part of everything that we do, like eating and breathing. And so, of course, if your children are reading, let them read away. And we'll be having a whole podcast on appropriate literature for children, but let them read away. And also reading as a family. I think the reading with the family is wonderful. And if you're camping or if you're out in other places, storytelling. I mean, that's just part of life. But just really holding on to that beauty of summer. And of course, if you're working parents and you have them in the different camps, well, then, you know, of course, that's a different kind of expansion for them than the school year, but also really treasuring that evening time with them and not scheduling in additional things, just having it be picnic in the park when you pick them up, or not, you know, having to take them to yet another activity, and just simplifying life.
So let's take summer, for example. Let's start with summer. And like, what are some of activities, some things that we can do to get a summer rhythm? So you mentioned a few. What else do we have here?
So, well, depending upon where you live, you're right. going to take advantage of that natural environment around you. And the longer days mean we can stay out later. And of course, we're going to be talking more about bedtime rituals as well. But, you know, there is a little bit more expansion there. And taking advantage of, even if it's just dinner time out in the park, that we want to be able to do that. And then depending upon geographically where you're at, taking advantage of whether it's the mountains or the beach or the desert that you're exploring. And so I think that really just having to create that space for exploration is huge.
Yeah, I would agree. And I think the camping, the experiences that you can bring to your children, or whether maybe you don't camp, but maybe you like road trips, or you mm-hmm. have to stay in the hotel, the Airbnb, going to theme parks or mm-hmm. going to different cities or going, you know, international travel, this is the time to do it.
Mm-hmm. Or beach combing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, just mm-hmm. anything that is different from that, the school year routine, whether you homeschool or you have your children in public school or private school, but just different from that routine. Summertime is for adventure.
Yeah, definitely. And then we get ready, we get August, mm-hmm. right? Which is, as I said, coming more fall-like in a way, but it's still summer, you know. Right. And then as we go into September, we're going to go into fall, which is another, I think that's my second favorite season. Mm-hmm. But what are some things that we can do for fall?
So in the fall, we're really looking at that sort of fortifying ourselves for the coming year. And in the Waldorf tradition, there's a wonderful celebration of Saint Michael, and it's that he's fighting the dragon. And so he's really preparing and gaining that courage and preparing for the coming darkness. And so there's all the metaphors around that, but really we're planning for winter. So historically, people have been harvesting, they've been gathering food, they've been making sure that their pantries are filled. And so, of course, in modern day, we can go to the supermarket and we don't have to have our pantries filled. But the rhythm of those activities, there's things that you can do with your children, whether you go, you know, and picking and harvesting fruit, whether you're going and gathering things to be stored, whether you're going, of course, to the pumpkin patch and getting things ready. I mean, of course, that's in our culture. That's a real tradition. And there's cultures, you know, different traditions around the world. So finding what works for your family in that fall season.
Yeah, one thing I think of is I think of the apples. I think we're always doing the apples, mm-hmm. the apple pies. We're doing getting the apple core. That's a great, if you have little kids, getting the apple core and making the apple pies, the baked apples, as well as the pumpkin patch, like you said. I think one thing to think about with through all these seasons is the farmer's market can mm-hmm. really be a great tool for curriculum, for inspiration, for the summer fruits, for example, kind of going back to summer, but fall time, the harvest, you know, really using those vegetables and those fruits that are coming to fruition and being able to create stories with those storytelling. And like you said, there's a lot of lore around this time of year, you know, in preparation for the winter.
I love that idea of the farmer's market, because really you could make an entire year long curriculum just around the farmer's yeah. market and what's in season.
We have done
and
that.
Fall, and we have yeah. done that many, many times. I'm thinking of the apple activities mm-hmm. that you would bring into the mm-hmm. classroom. Mm-hmm. And Also, there's a wonderful book by Tasha Tudor called A Time to Keep, and it's probably my all-time favorite about the seasons. And it's a little girl asking her grandmother, Granny, what was it like when Mummy was a little girl? Very East Coast, very late 1800s, early 1900s, but the traditions are just beautiful. And there's so many ideas there. In the fall, there's also this time of Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. They would do literary performances. And so one of the things that we would do in our family was with the fall activities, each family would prepare a little vignette, whether it was a skit or a story or a song. And so again, it's that preparing for those longer nights, the shorter days. So we're harvesting, we're memorizing, we're preparing for that coming darkness. And so I loved the traditions from that book. When we would read that with our family, we got all sorts of ideas. You know, summertime was the puppet shows and the marionettes and the things out on the river, but fall was that coming in and doing the poem
recitations. We would do that on Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. The kids would pick their poem in October or something, you know, and then we can also talk about Halloween, Dia de los Muertos, using those celebrations to celebrate. And really, I think that's such a strong piece of childhood is mm-hmm. those traditions, you know, that are being carried through.
When we think back to our own childhood memories, I think that the things that really stand out are the trips and then those celebrations, yeah. the things that in the family, the foods, the special foods. And so really this whole concept of if we look at the celebrations throughout the year and we look at the farmer's market and what is in season, we can really look at creating curriculum that is really nourishing and nurturing for our families. So then, of course, going into winter, depending upon where you live, but, you know, really the different kinds of things now in the evenings, wonderful storytelling, the reading of the stories, the creating epic types of games that we can be doing, and then the
arts and crafts, getting ready for the holidays. And mm-hmm. I immediately think of the long, cold winter. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember when we read that as a family, and just, you know, that is from Laura Ingalls Wilder.
Oh, the long winter, yeah.
I said wrong. But yeah, the long winter of just you hear it from a different perspective and just a serious perspective where lives were lost and
mm-hmm. life was hard.
Yeah. And so it just puts things into perspective. I remember we also read about the Donner Party and, you know, during the long winter. And mm-hmm. stuff.
It's a time of appreciation mm-hmm. for what we have and for the hard work that we've put in. And so, you know, nowadays in society, we do have to sort of simulate a bit of this, but our children exactly. love to do those different activities, even if we'd roast the nuts or we'd, you know, get whole walnuts and be cracking them every night. And again, that with December, regardless of your family traditions, they're all sort of festivals of light. We're bringing light to the shortest, darkest night of the year. So solstice, Christmas, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa,
Santa Lucia Day.
Yeah, all of these different festivals of light. So we're trying to bring that light. And then also the gratitude, the generosity, the giving of gifts. Most cultures have those traditions around that. And so that's that beauty of winter. And then also sleeping more.
Yes.
Eating a little bit heavier, you know, the comfort mm-hmm, foods. Mm-hmm. We have family in Scandinavia, and we would ask about, you know, in the winter, what do you do? And they said, we sleep more. And we've been there in the summer and they don't sleep much at all. And we said, when do you sleep? And they said, in the winter. And so, you know, taking advantage of that as well and just slowing down the pace a little bit, trying to really hold on to our resources.
It might also be an opportunity to less screens. You know, when the kids were little, before we had screens, we would say, especially on solstice, is like, we're not doing any electricity. Mm-hmm. You know, it'd be just be a candlelight day.
Oh,
but maybe, you know, with the influx of the screens, maybe making more intentional days like that for more sleep.
Yeah. And there's also so many different, you know, evening activities that we can be doing as families, even just expanding the cooking to include everybody, but then picking different games. We do a solstice spiral mm-hmm. for winter solstice where the children, we do an evergreen spiral outdoors and lit with candles, and the children walk the spiral. And they sort of let go of some of the thoughts from the previous year and then set their intention for the coming year. And that's become a tradition that our family has really loved and appreciate. And then, of course, New Year's, setting intentions for the new year. So wintertime, I have to say, every season has aspects that are just so fun. It's beauty, yes.
All right. So then we move on to spring, which is another fabulous season. Like, yeah, every season definitely has its beauty. But I think spring is pretty tops there with the bloom and with mm-hmm. the, you know, new life. like you said, the baby, the new life, and flowers abound, and making the trips to go see the wildflowers and pointing them out to your children.
The new animals, new life, going to visit the farms and see there's not a child that I've ever seen that doesn't go, oh, when they see those baby animals. And so whether it's chicks or baby goats or sheep or whatever it is, there's a farm near you somewhere that you can take your children to if you don't live on a farm yourself. And so really taking advantage of that idea of new life. One of my favorite stories is of children. We would always raise chicks in the classroom every year. And I would watch children hold the chicks in their hands. And no matter how young the child and how rambunctious the child, when they took that living little fragile creature in their hand, they just knew to be gentle, and just that feeling of reverence and appreciation that every little child would display is just so precious. So, you know, creating those opportunities for your children to experience that if possible is so, so important.
Every spring you would do the chicks and you would also do the silkworms.
Oh, the silkworms.
We're like, yeah, right. Still talk about that. Yeah. And I know a lot of other classrooms that are doing that.
Right.
Yeah.
So they're experiencing the cycle, the life cycle, but that, especially that birth and then the growth, and they see, and you can also do that with plants. There's such simple activities to do with sprouting, whether or not you can create a garden of your own. You can do little simple sprouting activities in your house with a sweet potato or an avocado pit, or just even planting beans or something like that. Mm-hmm. So the children can really see that cycle of life and how things sprout and grow. And
yeah, wheatgrass is a really easy one. You just need a sprouting screen, and super fun and easy one to do, just rinsing it every day for 5 days.
Right. And then of course at the farmer's market, we're going to have all of these beautiful new greens and the new berries coming in. And so that first harvest of the spring, and appreciating all that's bringing in nourishment and in excitement and regeneration. And so again, this is starting to be that beginning of the expansion. So we can spend more time outdoors. We can be exploring more. We can be mushrooming and just enjoying all that the area around you has to offer. So it's really a fun. And then also there's that, regardless of how you're educating your children, there's a little bit of that, that rising sap in the maple trees and the other trees as well, but the rising sap in our children. So we start to see more energy coming in and they're excited to get out. And so we have to, take care of that energy in appropriate ways. And so, letting them run more, taking them out to places and letting them explore. And if the weather is warm enough, the swimming and just being out there.
And celebrating their transition, for what they've learned during the school year and everything, I think is also an important thing to recognize and to appreciate how much they have grown
and to honor
exactly.
Really, and it's a nice time to mark that passage of time as well. And so I think of in our family, we've had lots of different traditions in the springtime, but however you celebrate it, the egg is a symbol in so many cultures of that rebirth. And so we've done lots of different activities with that, whether we hollow them out and make an egg tree, or we've done the Paisanki eggs where you're doing the wax on that. And that's another wonderful one that is so detailed, and even very young children can do that. So again, I'm going to refer back to that Tasha Tudor book, A Time to Keep, for additional activities and ideas. It's really fun to see the way they celebrated the year over 100 years ago. And I think that when we look at children, they appreciate doing all of those arts and crafts and handcrafts and handwork from days gone by. And so we can bring those in and we can recreate them for our children, and they resonate with them just as much now as they did years ago.
And one thing, how we got this started, it was a perfect segue, Maria, was talking about seasonally, we're talking about taking advantage of stuff in your community, was the county fair.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're doing that handwork, you put it aside. And then when your county fair comes around, you have your children display their work. They love to showcase their work.
Oh, and the county fair is such an incredible opportunity because they will accept the whatever it is that has been created, even if it's like the little veggie creatures. And so every family can enter something in the fair. It doesn't have to be the expert quilters.
Right.
So I know I was intimidated for years, and then I started watching what different families were entering in the fair and went, oh my gosh. And so then when the kids go and see that they've won a ribbon, it's so exciting.
Yeah, we're getting ready ourselves right now. So
nice. I love that. Mm-hmm. So anyhow, any other ideas on that for now?
No, I think that's good. We're yeah, we were just like, what should we talk about today? And we talked in the county fair and seasonally. And I just think it's something that we will keep touching on for sure. But I think it's just to be intentional, you know, and even for a lot of the stuff we talk about, it's like we come from the homeschool background. We come from that, but this is for everybody, really. Mm-hmm. You know, it's for everybody. It's experiential.
It's family life with intention. Yeah. So we're looking forward to sharing more. I think we'll probably go into that seasons of life at some point in the future. Definitely literature coming. So yeah. We'll look forward to hearing from all of you about your ideas as well. Until next time.
Thank you for joining us on
The Moms I Know.
Thanks for joining us today for The Moms I Know. To learn more about Sheila and her online program, The Mom Map, visit purplebeetnutrition.com. For Maria's monthly blog and to learn more about her group programs and retreats, visit SoquelEssentials.com. That's SoquelEssentials.com. We hope you enjoyed today's episode of The Moms I Know. Until next week, have a joyful family journey.